did a Peter Tork like, no, this I mean, yes. This
meeting is being recorded.
Cool. All right. One moment, please. Here we go. And we are, I believe, live on, we're going to be live on the Zilch Facebook page in just a moment. So I'm going to be concentrating on this. All right, everybody, we're live. We're live on Facebook and we are recording. Welcome to 7A Records live listening party of the four. We're not?
No, it's on. Yeah. I'm looking at it. Hey, everybody.
We live? Good.
We are live.
We're live. Hey.
Hi. Alive. Cool. We're alive.
Beautiful. I was getting a delay on my own voice. I'm like, well, how is that happening? Okay, so this is the 7A listening party for the four-track Dolan's Sings Nesmith EP. These tracks are glorious, and I think some of you are probably going to hear them for the first time. I heard them just a few days ago, but let me introduce the man who brought us all together and made this record possible. Glenn from 7A, ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Glenn.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for joining. Thank you so much for joining us. I think the idea behind this is really to this gathering today is to preview the new EP and let everybody hear it. And I thought, why not bring together sort of a handful or 10 of the biggest fans that I could think of in the same room and let them hear it first, basically, and see what people think. And that's the idea behind it.
So let's get right into it, right? Track number one, Soul Winter's Birthday, Glenn.
Soul
Writer's Birthday. That's right, Soul Writer's Birthday. So tell us the story on this, right? How did this song appear on the EP? How did it come about? And does anybody know the backstory on this?
Well, it was actually Andrew Sandoval, who was A&R manager on the project. Who brought this song in. He had heard Mike recorded a demo back in 1967 and he brought it into the recording when Mickey recorded this album, and he said, why don't we try and do this one? It would be quite cool to have an unreleased Nesmith tune on here. And I don't actually know a lot about it apart from that. Nobody seems to know anything about it except that Nesmith registered the song in 1967. But never actually did a finished recording of it, only a demo. So it's the first time it ever sees the light of day.
Fascinating.
Incredible. That's incredible.
Well, yeah. So how many of you guys have not heard this track? Let me see some hands.
I haven't heard it.
I've only heard.
Man, okay. If Fred hasn't heard it, it's deep. It's a deep, rare cut, man. So, all right, cool. Well, let's play it. What I'm gonna do? I'm gonna fade out with maybe like half a minute or so, or about 20 seconds left. So I'm gonna manufacture a fade. So, so here it is, track one, Soul Writer's Birthday.
Calling out.
So I don't want to play the whole track, right? But holy first season monkeys, Batman, right?
Yeah, exactly.
That's what it sounds like.
I mean,
very Star Collect, very Star Collector.
Right. Yeah. Like the Bobby Hart keyboards, right at the top, right? And you can kind of picture a romp happening while this record is playing.
Right.
You know?
Right.
It sort of has a salesman type groove at the beginning.
Yeah.
That's exactly what I said to my like as it was playing. I know you people hear Star Collector, but I hear salesman. So
yeah, me too.
Sort of tapioca tundra type lyrics as well.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah.
About those lyrics, yeah. I mean, I was just listening and picking them up, and there's so many clues and so many Easter eggs about the lyrics. It's great. Mm-hmm.
Yes, can we talk about the lyrics a bit?
Yeah, let's talk about the lyrics.
Okay, we're going to analyze the lyrics of Soul Rider's Birthday by Michael Nesmith. Now, keep in mind, not all birthday parties are on the actual date of the person who was having their birthday, right? So, like, if it was your birthday today, we might celebrate it next weekend. So that's a possibility. So I don't know. But the first set of lyrics are, I believe the person is high and riding on a donkey. Well, okay. So the lyrics are, while riding on a donkey with a bright golden mane, I saw a prima donna who was acting quite insane, calling out for all to hear a name that made no sense, while holding up for all to see a broken circus tent. Was he talking about, you know, the word that has the name that has no meaning? Was that Major Coco? Was it talking about Mickey was circus boy because the broken circus tent, right? So mm-hmm. I'm wondering if this is that. Like, is he actually talking about Mickey? Because it seems, you know, at one point it seems like he's talking about, you know, it seems like he's talking about all the monkeys. But then it keeps coming back to Mickey. It keeps coming back to Mickey. And I have done every search that I know how to do, Boolean searches, whatever, but I've not found anyone that it would work that June 25th was like, oh, wow, it's, you know.
I got it. I know what it is. What? I do know what it is. June 25th, 1966 was the final day of the first official Monkees recording session. And it was on that day that two of Nesmith's songs were recorded. It was the first Nesmith songs ever recorded on that day, June 25th, 1966. It was Kind of Girl I Could Love and All the King's Horses, All the King's Men. He is the soul writer. And it was the birth of his music.
Mind blown.
You're welcome. And thank you, Andrew Sandoval. I got that right out of his book. I mean, come on, guys. Don't we all have that? I mean, I happen to be sitting on my copy of his newest book because otherwise I'd be too short for the camera.
You are standing up.
I am standing up. That's
day
right.
Day by day, the monkey story, a veritable tome of information and a great booster seat.
And a booster seat as well. That's right.
I've got an email
up in the corner of my car. That's where the axle's sitting on right now in the garage.
Glenn, I'm sorry.
I got an email from Pete Finney the other day who played pedal steel guitar on this song. And he said he would love to, obviously he'd love to get a copy, which I'm going to post him. Because he said, I did lots of crazy stuff on the pedal steel on this particular track. So that instrumental break you hear in the middle, that's a lot of that has to do with him. And the Hammond organ, of course. Jim Cox plays the organ.
Cool.
Those drums are nice and tight, man. And it's kind of interesting. Mickey sings kind of in the back of his throat just a little bit.
It's got the slight radio voice effect that Christian.
Right. That compression is there, but Mickey sings it in the back of his throat to kind of give it that first season before the tonsillectomy Nesmith kind of sound. I think that's really cool. And as I was listening to this, I thought about like Nez's early influences. We talked about this on the thing with Christian the last time we did this, but this is a very Bo Diddley kind of rocker, that boom chicka boom chicka boom chicka boom chicka kind of rhythm going all the way through it. And you know, when you think about Nesmith writing, he wrote everything on guitar, you know, with chords. He according to legend, he started playing his chords to set his poetry to music. And this is, it's a very rhythm centric kind of cut. You could hear, like, it's easy to imagine the first season Monkees playing this on set, because it's open chords, kind of all the way through. It's really nice. What'd you guys think? Do you like it?
I like it. It's very,
I do too.
I think it's fantastic.
Love the bass.
If I can jump in real quick, I'd kind of like, almost like to hear, I mean, obviously we'd all like to hear what Nez's original demo sounded like, because I'd like, I'd like to hear just
looking at you, Andrew, looking at you.
Yeah.
He's got the tape.
If only because I'd like to hear what Christian did as far as rearranging and changing things around, because we know from the Dolan Sings Nesmith album that the arrangements of the songs are nothing like the original recordings. So when we're talking about, you know, the sound and productions and everything, you know, how it sounds like it could have been on a Monkees thing, or how Nez wrote it, it's kind of hard for us to tell how Nez wrote this, because all we're hearing is what Christian did for this recording and this production.
And what Mickey's,
I don't even know if the demo had any vocals on it. It might just be an instrumental demo, but that's something we need to ask Andrew at some point.
Interesting.
I'm curious, Glenn, did you have a chance to talk with Andrew or any of the band members, and were they able to share if Nez had any recollection of the song?
I emailed Nesmith and got no reply. And I emailed Andrew and got no reply on this particular song. So I think very little is known, is what I believe. But we should ask Andrew again and see if he knows anything.
He'll pull it out for the Nesmith Sings, or Dolan Sings Nesmith box set, the Handmaid set. Yeah.
what I would like to hear is if there were lyrics for Don't Cry Now, that's on the Wichita Train Whistle album. I would like to know if there's a vocal version. I mean, I've been wondering that for years, but I'm glad to hear this song, which I've never heard before. And I think it's amazing I think Mickey did a good job on this. And who's the producer? Is it Andrew or is it Christian?
Christian.
Okay, he did a fantastic job on this one. And if there's a third volume of or a third version of Dolan Sings Nesmith, Don't Cry Now, okay?
Do we want to finish the lyrics, or?
Yeah, what do you got, Ken?
Okay, so the second verse is, I saw brightly colored neon lights trickle through his hair, casting weirdly shaped shadows here, there, and everywhere. Leading little children through the park, watching out for rain, telling fairy tales and preaching love amongst some other things. And it's talking about in the park, you know, like when Mickey was in the park with the kids over in England and all that, and the here, there, and everywhere thing. The neon lights and candy reminds me of, what's the monkey song about the club?
Daily Nightly?
Daily Nightly.
Yeah, it's kind of got a little bit of that. But then the third verse, it says he's living in a canyon house with cats and whirlybirds. I wonder if one of those cats is Shorty Blackwell. Anyway, strung out behind incredible as his favorite word. And, you know, Mickey, incredible, right? So looking down and growing up with one eye partly blind, looking through telescopes, okay? Eating chocolate covered grass and loving porcupines. So somebody's having some fun brownies. So there you go.
Yeah. So this song appears to be about Mr. Dolan's with his
whirly
birds.
Seems like it to me.
Hmm.
I don't know. The donkey with the bright and golden mane, though, isn't that Peter?
I don't know.
Would the prima donna maybe be Davy? I don't want to cast aspersions on anyone, but
Maybe when he was doing his salad thing, right?
Exactly. Yeah. He did seem, you know, just a little aloof, maybe to Nez, and maybe the other vice versa. Who knows?
I didn't want to say anything, but prima donna. When I heard that, that was my first thought.
So maybe it's going back to like he's acting like you need to eat your salad properly, and then he starts tossing it all over the place, literally.
Huh.
That could be the insane.
But you're right. I mean, by far the majority of the lyrics point to Mickey.
Calling out for all to hear a name that made no sense. That's Magicogo to me. So,
Well, the truth is unfortunately lost to time, but that's the beauty.
I think
of
we found
art.
A lot of it, though, right?
I think we did too. Glenn, can you comment on this? Was there ever a discussion about this, or were the tapes delivered to you and you said, "Oh, this is nice"?
No. I think Christian and Andrew did a lot of the A&R together. And obviously, Mickey and myself were involved in the discussions as well. But it really came down to what songs Christian felt worked for him, which songs he could work with and rework, and what would work for Mickey as well to sing. And I think there was a few songs that we thought was going to be definitely on there to begin with. And then once Christian started playing around with them on the guitar, he found out they didn't actually work. And we didn't just want to do a karaoke album where you copy the original arrangements, right? Because we didn't think there was much point in that. And some of the songs just didn't really lend themselves to being reworked, and others really did. So ended up with different songs than we thought we would have. And but I'm really pleased with how it came about and how you know, the final result.
And there you go.
Tracked. I am really glad that, seriously, Glenn, I am really glad that you held this for the EP, because it makes this one special. Because this is something that was literally lost to time, and that's what 7A does time and time again, bringing us things that were lost to time. And you know, even in our own fandom, we've got Monkees fans that are hearing, you know, whether it's on MMR or re-releases, like you've got a new exciting release that you're going to be doing a re-release soon. And it's stuff that was lost to time for all intents and purposes. And you're putting a brand new coat of paint on this stuff, bringing it up to modern standards and in a good way. Like nothing's being brickwalled or crappy, you know what I mean? But like when you get a release from 7A, you know that you're getting something of quality each time out the gate. So I just want to thank you for
thank you. Now I just want to point out that the all of these songs were meant to have been on the album itself, because you could easily fit them on. Maybe not on the vinyl. You would probably struggle to fit them on the vinyl, but you could certainly have, you know, they would have fitted on the CD. But it was felt that the album would be too long for the casual listener if they're all on there. And I actually agree with that. I think it's a really good album as it is, Dolan Sings Nesmith, and we had to make some tough choices. And there was no particular reason why these four songs were chosen. That was a decision that was sort of taken between us, and we all had our own favorites, and we ended up with an agreement on, you know, but there was quite a lot of discussion going back and forth, but there was no real reason why these four ended up on the EP. It was nothing that we had sort of planned to begin with. The original plan was to fit them all on the album.
You're not that diabolical, Glenn, that you're just like, I'm just going to keep these.
No, okay. Yeah.
Cool.
No, that would be a shame. And actually, this song, Soul Rider's Birthday, I think it was track 9 or something originally on the album. And it was one of my go-to tracks every time I was in my car. I had a CDR, and so my initial reaction was I was a little disappointed that it was dropped from the album. But after a while, and after discussing it, I think the album, it made sense. And I think the original album was good as it was. And I could see why it was suggested to move this one to the EP. And I'm quite happy with that now. And I'm just pleased to be able to bring it out, you know, in a different format.
Very good.
Yeah, it's a great track. Okay, speaking of great tracks, track 2, Some of Shelley's Blues. Let's just play it.
Tell me again, don't think that you'll convince.
someone breaks your heart, you cry your eyes red. But there's nothing so hard about the life that you've led. As far as I can see, there's no reasons for goodbyes. You're just running scared.
So I gotta cut it there, but I will be darned if that doesn't sound like a Red Rhodes pedal steel, man.
Yeah, really.
Very nice.
So
fantastic banjo too.
Yeah, the fantastic banjo.
Maybe it's a B bender. Was that a pedal steel or was it an electric guitar with a B bender?
I think that's definitely Pete Finney.
Yeah.
It's gotta be.
It is Pete Finney.
I like the fact that they kept it pretty much to the original arrangement, which just a little touch here and there just to make it a little different. And Mickey's fit with that.
It's
such a great song to begin with. And that they honored the original arrangement. It was a very nice touch.
Definitely
very close to like the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band, but maybe even more so. There were a couple bands in the 80s that covered it, like the Maines Brothers. I'm hearing a lot of that. And not that I was influenced by a lot of that, but this was just a stellar version. I think this stands out.
You remember the Maines Brothers?
If you're a pedal steel player and you don't know Lloyd Maines, you're not a pedal steel player.
There you go, right?
Definitely very heavy on Christian's little Griffin, the little mini 12 string. He's definitely using that all over this track.
That's what I think. I noticed is comparing it in my head, it seems to me that the version, which one was it released on? Well, it doesn't matter. The one that I think we're all familiar with seems more pedal steel heavy. And this is using it in a more judicious way. This is more finger picking of an arrangement. And I really like it a lot. I think it highlights the Finney's pedal steel really nicely.
Yes.
Can I ask a question to Mark Kleiner?
Yeah.
Mark?
Yo.
Now, I know that you're writing the notes to the last album and this one. When you hear these songs, like, what's going through your head is you're like, you know, that first time. And then, like what's your process to writing the liners? Other than just, like, here's who played on what and yada, yada, yada.
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, it's this whole, because I was blessed to hear these songs before they were sequenced for both the LP and then the EP, right? So, I mean, first and foremost, I come at it as a fan, right? Just like all of us, I think, here. And then as a historian, right? So it's kind of that dance with it. And what I try to do with my liner notes is either stay out of the way of the music, but also see how I can tell us the story. You know, like, or a story to hopefully add some, you know, some color to it. But I mean, this is just, I remain blown away by this and hearing Mickey's voice on these songs and Christian. It's that kind of a trinity between Christian and Mickey and Michael, right? In terms of like, and just, you know, I was just really, really fell in love with this album, and it really kind of made me more aware of the love and respect Michael and Mickey, you know, had for each other, you know, and I think we've really started to see that the last several years, you know, with them, this, in a way, unlikely duo. I mean, if you had told me in the early 80s that this was going to transpire, right?
Right.
Like it just, I still, like, I came into the fandom at 10 years old in like 80, 81 when Mickey was Michael Dolenz, right? And so I still wrap my head around all this kind of, you know, so that was one of the things I thought was hilarious that, you know, neither of them wanted to be, Mickey didn't want to be Mickey then. Michael didn't want to be Mike. And then they released the Mike and Mickey or show, right? So,
I don't know. Yes.
What's that?
Say that again, Fred.
And then he throws in Nez, just to make help.
Totally. True.
There is such an affection in Mickey's voice that is really obvious in this cut. That's there. It's present in every other track on this album, but this is the one where it kind of poked me in the eyes. There's such an affection in Mickey's voice for Nesmith himself in this track. If you listen very carefully, there's just this brotherhood in his voice, just a soul that is, like I said, always present, but very, very much on display in this track, more so than the others.
Yes, great.
I'm just so happy that we managed to release the album while Nesmith was still with us.
Yeah.
And he got to hear all of the songs, including the EP songs. He heard all of those, and he was very complimentary about them. And I've heard that he said he was proud of them. So that means a lot, and I'm just so happy that we managed to do that.
Excuse me, Glenn. What did Nez think about them doing the unreleased song? Did he have any comments on that?
No, he didn't comment. I mean, and I didn't speak to him directly about it. I know Mickey spoke to him, and I think Andrew must have, but I didn't speak directly to Nesmith about them.
Cool. Well, then let's move on, because we got two more tracks, right? Here, this is track 3, The Crippled Lion.
Slowly I walk through the gentle pouring rain. I know that I will never pass this way again. Never. Teardrops chafing my eyes, longing to be where the melted kisses fall, lingering and still, while quietly they tell them all. Blue is the color. Nothing stops when everything is done. Now my whole world opens up in different rhymes and tunes, with highways making up the verse. And then suddenly I see the light of something called the moon. And though my path is planned, it's not rehearsed. And so I move along to the next thing on the list, knowing full well that some of them just don't. Where my foot steps down is where it's home.
I really, really hate having to stop that. Wow.
I was gonna ask you to leave it running because there's a fantastic instrumental there just when you faded it out.
Glenn, if you want me to play it, I'll play it. But I love leaving it on the table. And what I really noticed about this was watching everybody's face as you're Brady Bunched on my screen, because every single one of us was like, oh, I miss this guy so much. Yeah. You know, yes, like we were all there. And then and hearing not Mickey's rock and roll voice, but Mickey's Broadway voice in this is just so beautiful. Like this is like from the second act of a Broadway musical, when you know the character has lost all hope and he's alone on stage and this is his spotlight number, you know. Just what an amazing vocal performance.
But also the cello played by Cameron Stone, he did a fantastic job.
Lovely.
Yeah, it reminds me of what Elvis Costello did with something like the Juliet Letters. You know, it has that kind of tone to it and everything, the way he did the music. And yeah, when you hear the lyrics now, you miss Menez. You just missed it, man. And that song brings that out. And maybe you just gave Mickey an idea to do a stage show featuring these songs. That'd be great.
Dolan sings Nesmith, the musical.
It's
a sign of a great song, isn't it? It's the sign of a great song when you can take it and completely change it like that, and it still works. I mean, I love the original. I really love the original, Nesmith's original, but I also love this version. And that's the whole point, that you are able to like more than one version of a song.
Absolutely.
Crippled Lion has long been one of my favorite
gorgeous
Nesmith songs in any incarnation, and this one is just,
it's beautiful. It's a beautiful version.
And I'd like to talk about the lyrics and the cover of the album. Blue is the color of the sun, and Scott Erickson's beard.
Purely coincidental, my friend. Purely coincidental.
Yes.
He dyed his beard just for this broadcast, ladies.
Yeah.
But let's talk about the cover a little bit, because the cover of Dolan Sings Nesmith and Dolan Sings Nesmith EP is as different as night and day. And one looks like it's under the moonlight, if you will.
I see what you did there.
Under the silver moon. So, Glenn, let's talk a little bit about the cover art.
But it kind of has an even deeper meaning now with Nesmith passing away and everything. But in all honesty, we it took us by surprise, you know, and we were heartbroken when Ness died. And this was all ready to go before he died. I was just about to put it into production. So there was no sort of real... It wasn't sort of an attempt to make it a night scene because of his passing or anything like that.
No.
That was already decided on.
Wow.
I loved the original cover, but I thought, how can we get an EP cover that goes with the original so that it'll feel part of the same album? It's like an extension to the album, right?
Yes.
And that was the whole idea. And our designer, Tim, I think did great.
Yes, he did.
I personally love it. I mean, I love the original cover with a reflection of the Nilsson Sings Newman album. Mm-hmm. But when I saw the EP cover, I just thought it was brilliant. I mean, I know it's so simple, yet it's so perfect.
But it actually is partly, you know, Mickey's fault as well, because it was down to him. You know, he had a lot of ideas for the cover, and we went in lots of different directions. And we sent him a lot of visuals, and he was actually the one who selected this particular cover.
Wow. Well, Mickey often says that his favorite color is blue, so it's definitely blue is the color of the sun. Scott's beard.
But also on the album cover, we had at one point we had a UFO, we had a hang glider, we had lots of Easter eggs and stuff, and in the end, Mickey said no, let's take them all off because they got nothing to do with the music on the album, really. I don't, you know, we don't need a UFO. And you know, I think he was right.
I don't think Mickey wants to be reminded of hang gliding.
So, but we did spend a long time undercover. We did. So and he did select the final one that he preferred.
And it was originally going to be just on vinyl, correct? Like when it was originally announced.
Yeah, that was me. I'm happy to admit that I was wrong, because I thought I'd never in my life actually released a CD EP. I'd never done a short CD before, and I thought this is probably just going to be my instant thought was going to be, this is like the Good Times EP. This is like and that was the aim for this. It was trying to, because I loved that. I bought that myself when it came out. And I thought, why don't we try and sort of replicate that and do something similar with the artwork?
But Glenn, you can tell them that you heard me scream no when I found out that it was, because I need it on CD too. So you can tell.
No, but instantly after posting it on social media, instantly, loads of messages saying, "Is it not on CD?" And I thought, oh, I mean, you know, we missed a trick. And I've got, you know, but thankfully, CD is a very, you know, very fast to manufacture compared to vinyl, and we managed to get them both released at the same time next week.
Well, Glenn, well, for,
you know, further proof that it's by fans for fans, right? Right, Fred?
Yes, definitely. And Glenn, when you before you decide doing a CD, you're gonna put a download around the same time as well, or just it was just
on the same day? Yeah, on the 18th. The 18th of March is the release date. And,
right.
So the vinyl, the CD, and the digital release is all on the 18th.
Perfect trifecta. Definitely.
Now, if we can get the version for the 8-track player in my car, I would be really, really happy. This is great.
Now you can do the Tears for Fears thing and put out a single.
There you go.
We need the Edison.
Cylinder. We need a cylinder.
and we need the wire recorder version.
Yeah, the wire recorder version would be.
Really I would buy them all. Yeah, I would buy every single one of them.
Yeah, we need 40 different colored vinyl variants.
Yes,
there's a new Aerosmith album out. I don't know if you've seen it, and it's got 14 different colored vinyl versions available. 14.
How McCartney of them?
That's 14.
Yeah. That's amateur. Yeah, that's because every shop, every chain of stores want their own exclusive, right? Yeah. So Barnes & Noble want the green vinyl. Walmart want another one, and you end up with 14 different versions. It's just insane.
That 14 is amateur. McCartney did like 30.
Yeah. And so, counting.
Yeah, I think that's wrong.
I wanted to mention something. I kind of noticed this, and Glenn, you and I talked about it a few days ago, and you was like, you said it was purely coincidental. But if you look at the back cover of Dolan Sings Nesmith, it was an unintended coincidence. It's kind of a flashback to the cover of Tropical Campfires. With the mesas and the mountains in the background.
Yeah, I actually did ask Tim Johnson about that, the designer, and he did say it was a coincidence.
Well,
when you search for a desert scene, That Colorado mountain comes up quite often.
Yeah, it was coincidental, but like I said, completely coincidental. But it was still a very nice little.
That's cool.
Unintended thing.
I'm going to go one step further, Scott, and like you got the front cover, which is like daytime. Then it starts to get a little more like dusk, and we're under the full moon on the next one. So,
wow.
And yes. Mine signed. So there you go.
I can reveal something else as well. It just came back to me. The very first draft of the cover was actually done by Dean Torrance from Jen and Dean.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
The Nilsson Sings Newman cover. Yeah.
And he sent a different, it was a different car. It was a car that I think he had drawn. And we tried lots of different versions using this car that Dean sent, and for some reason they just didn't work. It was the wrong car for this scene. It just didn't fit in the desert. It didn't look right, and that's a shame, because you know Dean, you know, lovely guy and very helpful. But Tim then took over and completely changed the cover, but still used the car idea. And
fantastic.
I think he did an amazing job.
Dean did a First National Band album cover too, didn't he?
Right, Magnetic South.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Yeah.
And Nevada Fighter, didn't he? He did the back photos anyway, but I don't remember if he did the cover as well.
Still, you know, nice way to, you know, keep it in the family. All right, our final track, ladies and gentlemen.
Time to rock out.
This one's a kicker. All right, if you guys got headphones, I hate to sound like Todd Rundgren, but if you got a set of headphones, you better get them out and cranked up, because. That is the gift that keeps on giving, because every time I hear that track, I hear something new, right? It's either the Tack Hammer piano or Searcy on Searcy on Searcy on Searcy on Searcy with those amazing background vocals, man, or like everything in it is great. The drums are great. The bass is great. That piano is fantastic. And I mean, you know, Mickey's voice is the best it's ever been.
Yeah,
I mean that's such a rocking little track, and he keeps in kind of that smoldering sexiness that the original track has, you know.
Yeah,
it's great. Like I loved watching Fred rock out to this track, man. It's
just... Yeah, dude.
Yeah. What'd you guys think?
It's a great version that day. It was included on the CD version of the original album. And is it just me, or does the piano remind anybody of Oklahoma Backroom Dancer?
A little bit. Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah.
I was going to say it sounded a lot like Live at the Palais.
Yeah, I agree with that too.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah.
Oh, I was totally vibing FNB Redux at Troubadour. That's when I was standing there hearing them play that. That's what
Jim Cox, was. Right?
Yeah. This is, Jim Cox played on the Troubadour as well. It's the same guy. So yeah. So that explains that.
Jim Cox also a member of Ringo Starr's Roundheads.
Yes.
Side note there.
I'm glad the song's going to be available digitally for everybody who didn't get the vinyl or didn't get the CD version, because I know Glenn, it was only on the original CD, and there were people, I guess, that are a little peeved that it wasn't on the album, but I'm glad it's going
to
be more widely.
Yeah, but again, that comes down to, you know, I wasn't going to do the EP on a CD, right? I was just going to do it on the vinyl to start with. And of course, some people, very few people, I have to say, some people have noticed, well, we already had this on CD before, but you know, it just rounds off the EP very nicely, I think. And
well, I had a question about that. Since it was already previously released on a CD, was there any thought about you putting a different song or an alternate version of that song?
Yeah, no, I've spoken to Christian in the past about it, and he's not too keen on doing alternate versions. Like, when he does a version, he would like that to be the final version.
I can respect that. That makes perfect sense.
Right.
And,
plus, it's good for us as fans not having to chase down 23 different things. You know what I mean?
Well, I mean, Monkees fans have never purchased multiple copies of the same thing. Never.
I have friends who have got pretty much every variation of McCartney 3. Right, Scott?
I didn't even buy it once.
I'm up to about 10 of them.
And there you go.
Hey, Glenn, question. Is there anything else?
Not from it. These are all the 17 tracks now from this EP. No, that's it. That's it.
No, I mean from the sessions. Are there any more songs?
No, that's it. That's everything that was recorded.
Everything, okay.
And I think, you know, I hope you agree with me that they are all easily good enough to have been on the original album.
Oh, easily.
Yeah.
And it's. I'm just really pleased to be able to release them as an extension of the album.
It's cool.
Are there any thoughts of releasing it again in the future as a deluxe edition?
Well, I don't want to do that just for the sake of it. I mean, if we're going to do a deluxe, there would have to be something new to it, I think.
This round table is your bonus stuff. So, and it's worth every penny, Fred. And worth every penny.
I agree.
And if Mickey does take this Dolan Sings Nesmith to Broadway, you can always do the cast recording. So there you go.
Well, 54 below again and just do that.
That'd be cool. Well, I think with deluxe editions and things like that, you kind of have to bring something new to it.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe it's asking Mickey back in the studio if he wants to do a couple of more songs. Or but I'm really keen to get Mickey to do a whole new album. And I have been going on to him about it, and he seems to be interested, but it's just actually getting him to do it. So I'll keep asking.
Well, he's got so much time on his hands because the guy's never doing anything.
He's very busy, isn't he? He's
incredibly busy. Yeah. So that's the EP, ladies and gentlemen. Bravo. We loved it all the way around.
Bravo.
We loved it. Glenn, tell us how we can get our hands on it.
Right, so it's out next Friday, 18th of March, and it's on deepdiscount.com. Mickey's own website, both signed and unsigned versions on there, and available digitally from Apple Store and Amazon and every Spotify as well. And you can get physical copies on Amazon as well.
And if you are on the Zilch Facebook page in this thread, look below us talking. You'll see the links. I've dropped them there. So.
Thank you, Ken. Thank you very much.
That's what I do. I think we need to ask about what's coming soon from 7A as well.
Yeah.
I mean, well, that's kind of a Ken Mills special, right? But here we are.
Well, you put me on the spot. I did announce the other day that we've got a new Nesmith album coming out, and I don't know if you can see the 50th anniversary edition of And the Hits Just Keep On Coming.
Yes.
Oh. And that 7A logo looks so good there.
Easy, Tim. Easy there, Tim.
I mean, can you believe that this album is currently out of print? And I think it was actually Scott that pointed it out to me. It's out of print everywhere on every format. And what? It just seems such a shame because it's the 50th anniversary. It seems such a shame that that should pass by in silence. You know, we thought, you know. Yeah.
Even on video.
Sorry?
Even on video, it's out of print, except for the digitals.
I don't know if they put down...
It might still be there on Video Ranch, but on it's I think on video their digital is MP3.
I got no idea how Video Ranch works, whether they do their own presses or, but certainly on every label, and you go on Amazon or everywhere else and look on there, it's out of print.
Yep.
So it's a great, in my opinion, possibly his best album. And it would be such a shame if that, you know, 50th anniversary went by without anybody doing anything. And that was the idea behind it.
Wow.
Thank you. Wonderful record. When's that going to street, Glenn? Do you know?
May the 13th.
So, you know, it's weird. I just did a search on Amazon for the used price because the 50th anniversary Honey Beige one that you've got coming out is up there. But the one that was from RCA, it was going for like $130 this last week.
Yeah, it's not available.
It's sold out now. So people are buying that.
Which one? This one, Ken? The twofer?
No. The one from RCA, the original one.
Okay. Vinyl. Yeah. Oh, the vinyl. Okay. Because I mean, I've seen a couple of CDs. There was a Pacific Arts or Rio CD that came out several years ago, too.
Yeah.
But I know beyond the shadow of a doubt that this is the one that's going to sound the best.
Right. I'm looking at Amazon right now, and it's still available as an MP3 and streaming.
It's available digitally, but in physical format.
Yeah.
But vinyl and CD, it's high priced if you can find it.
Yeah. So wait just a little bit. Get your pre-orders now. For the Hits Keep On Coming 50th anniversary Honey Beige 180 gram vinyl, or you can get it on CD and electronic from 7A.
What number is that, Ken?
7A.
You beat me, and
remastered, right? So this isn't just I think what Glenn had told me in an email, this is a remastered version of the album, so it's not the same as
it's before. Right. It, there is a distinction though. It's not remixed, it's remastered.
Right.
So it is, we're basically working with the master that Sony gave us to work with, and we have remastered those to make sure that all the levels are right, and you know, they all sound as they should. But
good on Sony for still having the master tapes, man.
No doubt this will be the best sounding physical release of this album, bar none. I am willing to bet money that it will sound better than the original RCA pressings did in 72.
Listen to us, Glenn, selling your stuff before we've even heard it.
It's very kind. I just want to point out another thing. It has got three bonus tracks on there that are actually mixed by Andrew Sandoval. They are the ones that are available digitally, but they haven't been released on vinyl before.
Very good. Very nice.
So cool.
Nice and very tasty. Exciting.
And it comes with a 28-page color booklet if you get the CD. And
that's right, yeah.
And really, check it out.
There's quite a few unpublished photos in there by Henry Dills and a few other people.
Awesome. That's awesome.
Fantastic. So there you go.
We're working on Mickey's Demoiselle album as well.
People have been asking about that one.
And that's just about to go into production, so we'll have some news on that soon.
Fantastic.
The
monkey nerd in me, I have to mention this. I don't know if people pay attention to stuff like this, but if you ever look at the catalog numbers for these items, they all start with 7A, right? So the Nesmith and the Hits Keep on Coming, for example, has 7A042 LP. So there you go. You kind of know which release it is by the number and the label and everything. I just think it's really cool that all of us nerds who freak out every time we're near a highway that has 7A, or you get a bus ticket for a booth, you know, 7A appears anywhere. This is our thing, man.
There you go.
But I just want to, you know, I want to thank you all so much for your support, because I couldn't have done this without your help.
Well,
we couldn't do it without you.
Thank you enough for doing all of this. Yeah. I mean, this is the fans' dream come true, really. Yeah. And you're earning well-deserved respect within the inner circles of the monkeys, and that's obvious by the participation that you've already been getting, and I'm looking forward to many more.
And to think 7A all started out with this record right here.
It's behind me. Awesome.
All right.
And that was going to be it. Ian and I were going to put that out, and we're going to shake hands and go separate ways. And I said, why don't we do another one?
Then
we went and bought a whole bunch of them, and they're like, oh, there's money there. So
we should all do a shout out to Ian Lee, because it took both him and Glenn to get this going. So round of applause for Ian Lee too. You've done amazing carrying this on, and we are all glad to be behind you.
Thank you so much.
Another question. We already talked about the Mickey and Mike projects. Anything coming up in the future for Davey and Peter?
Yes.
Okay. I think we're going to have to leave it. We're going to have to leave it at that.
That's called a cliffhanger.
Yes, I can't wait to share the information. I can't share it yet, but the answer is yes, and I'm hoping both should be out this year.
Wow.
The only slight hesitation is because of the lead time on vinyl, and I need to make sure that we can get everything in by the end of this year. But I think that should be possible. Yeah.
So watch this space, right? Now, Glenn, you don't know about this, but I'm working on getting the master tapes from Lester Crabtree and the Three Crabs for a CD.
Oh, finally.
No, yeah. We've got to get working on. Yeah.
Well, if you get that, then you better get the Jolly Green Giants.
And the Secret Agents.
And the Four Martians. We might as well get everybody.
Glenn, you thought I was a nerd when I did this to you on the show, but we're all thinking.
We're all doing it. All right. So let's wrap it up. It's 10 o'clock in London, and Glenn's got to get up in the morning. So everyone, thank you so much for being a part of this.
It's great to see you all. And
Nice meeting you all.
Thank you. Yes.
Love you, Ed.
Thank you.
Good to see you.
Break legs, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye, Glenn.